Hey folks, Marco here. If you recall, last week's homework was to reconnect the two masks, prompts, and samplers in parallel. However, once you run the workflow, you would have realized that the sampling still happens sequentially. Nodes may be connected in parallel, but the two samplers still work independently from each other. So, how do we make the samplers talk to each other? The answer is in the title of the video, Regional Prompting. In this week's video, I am pushing its capabilities to its absolute limits by prompting for three different races, two subjects that are of different age, gender, wear different outfit, hairstyle, and so on. For a basic Stable Diffusion 1.5 model, I think it's pretty good. Do keep in mind that I won't be explaining how I made masks in today's video because we had extensive discussion on masking last week. This is now assumed knowledge. Next week, I will assume that you know what original conditioning is, and when we discuss temporal consistency of an animated character, I won't be explaining what IP adapter is. I do hope to turn this into a well-developed and scaffolded curriculum. So those watching this on Reddit, there was a reason for that past discussion, and I apologize if I have misled you. I'm not pulling topics out of my ass, I swear. Albeit, I can't say I have everything figured out either. Prerequisites for the video are the same. Link to my workflow is in the description. And with that said, let's jump in. All right, so as before, I shall import the workflow and then reset view and then zoom out. Let's begin by assembling groups 1 and 2. And when connecting reroute nodes, do make sure not to miss. Reroute nodes change their type dynamically. So if you make a mistake, you may need to fix the connections further along the workflow. Now I have 2 muted output nodes, which I shall unmute and then run the workflow just so you can see what masks I'm using. And now I will mute them again. So what do we have here? I have my base prompt, which is here. Then I have a mask for subject on the left, followed by the prompt on the left, and then mask for subject on the right and prompt describing subject on the right. Now note how I have structured my prompts. On the left side, so my left subject, the prompt is for African woman, and then it goes on to describe her appearance, her hairstyle, outfit, and then only at the end it says, oh, by the way, she's with a bloke in Beijing. With right subject, the prompt is the exact opposite. It goes in detail describing the man, his hairstyle, eyes, fashion, and so on. And at the end it says, oh, by the way, there's a woman next to him in Beijing. AI can only really handle well one subject at a time. So if you try to explain 2 people all at the same time in the same prompt, AI gets confused. In my base prompt, I have unified the 2 subjects under one. I have called them interracial couple. These prompts use minimal amount of negative prompting. I tend to add negative prompts only as I need them. So with words like embrace and love scene, there was a risk that AI might take that as making love scene, especially with words like interracial in the mix, but I still didn't put naked or nude in the negative because I was relying on the busy streets of Beijing. Even Stable Diffusion 1.5 knows that people of Beijing don't have orgies in the streets. Now let's add group 3 and then preview the output. Now I don't know what your expectations are, but for a model with 800 million parameters, that's pretty good. I mean, yes, you need to fix the hands and detailing and upscaling and all that, but overall, I don't think that's bad at all. Now let me connect groups 4 and 5 and then preview all 3 outputs. And once all the sampling finishes, this is our output. Hands again need more work, but hey, nothing new. Now when you look at my upscale group, one of the things that you will notice is that node doesn't actually have denoise. So sampler doesn't have denoise strength. Now before I explain to you how to work out denoise, I want to address a bigger question, which is why? Why did I put advanced sampler in a beginner's course? Let me just quickly paste some nodes on the side here. You see, difference between regular and advanced case sampler and difference between regular and advanced impact sampler isn't the same as the difference between these two. These two differ also in a way things get calculated behind. On his documentation page, Dr. Data the Legend says with regular sampler, sampling of the masks only happens after sampling of the background. Meanwhile, with the advanced node, sampling alternates at each step, which allows for smooth blending. Now, I understand that this is not for regional sampler, it's for a different one, but I do believe the same thing applies because that's why we have base-only steps that you specify here on the regional sampler regular, but that parameter doesn't exist in the advanced one. In saying that, do check if this video has any pinned comments, because that's where I will leave any errata. If I have misunderstood the developer, that is where I will post my corrections. So then, how do we work out the noise strength from this? Basically, you take the number of steps after the start and divide them by the total amount. So I have 55 steps after the start. So 55 out of 100 is 0.55. So that is my denoise strength here. And credit for this little calculation goes to developer Blender Neko, who has a nice documentation page describing each node. And here's the formula we're using. In fact, it is from Blender Neko that I have learned this syntax for the output save image node, putting two percentage symbols and then entering year, month, and day in this format. In fact, I will save the image using this node just to show you. So it is 4th of December, 3 p.m. here in Australia. And in my output folder, I have 4th of December. I open it up, 3 o'clock, I open it up, and there's my image. And in fact, it doesn't even stop there. If I want to test this with different settings, for example, I can set start at step to value, for example, 95. And then let's change this to something unique. There we go. Now I can just go here and put two percentage symbols, glitch regional dot start at step. Then at the beginning here, start step. Now let's see how this works out. I will press Control Enter, and before this finishes, I will change it to 90, then Control Enter, then I will change it to 85, Control Enter, and then once again at 80. Now we wait a little bit until it's finished, and our output files now look like this. Pretty cool, huh? Now, let me tidy up the workflow a little bit. Now, I have left you latent upscaler here as well, if you wanna give that one a try. Upscaling in latent space requires greater denoise, but I did manage to get some, let's just say, interesting results. Background is fine, and it's mostly the right number of fingers, but the face definitely needs some fixing, I would think. So yeah, feel free to experiment and see what you get. I want to finish off today with a couple of rapid-fire tips and remarks. Firstly, what I said last week about groups not snapping to grid, that doesn't seem to be the case anymore. I don't know if someone who knows the developers has watched my video and told them, or perhaps more likely my ComfyUI was out of date. Either way, now it works. Secondly, as you know, making a simple high-res fix workflow in ComfyUI takes considerable amount of effort. Fortunately for us, ComfyUI has an extension called Custom Scripts. Now, this extension does a lot. It is responsible for placing a nice-looking bookmark icon there, as opposed to the default globe for Google Chrome. So thanks to that extension, what I can do is I can right-click on Load Checkpoint and then click Add Prompts. If I then load my case sampler, I can then connect things to the case sampler. I then right-click on case sampler and choose Add Blank Input. I right-click again, choose high-res fix, and then right-click on this one and add save image. Now, VAE does need to be dragged from over here, but otherwise, that was a lot faster now, wasn't it? Tip number three, how do you simplify a complex workflow? Well, you already know one way to simplify workflows, and that is to use pipelines. This same workflow using Impact Pack looks like this. And of course, many other developers have those too. For example, in Jordan Thompson's library of nodes, it is called Bus Node. In Efficiency Nodes, it's called Pack Tuple. So you just have to know what it's called, that's all. And lastly, to simplify a workflow like this, one very useful feature that would come in handy, especially in this case when I'm dragging connection across the other side of the workflow, get and set nodes. These nodes you can get from either your lanes pack, easy use, or KJ node pack. Basically, I right click on a node and then I set the value. And then on the other end where I need that value to appear, I use get node. Your homework for this week is to fix the faces. The workflow looks like this. So your job is to use the groups on the right-hand side and assemble them in a way that will fix their faces. Expected learning outcome for the assignment is learning how to use SAM, that is Facebook's Segment Anything model. You see, if you try using regular bounding boxes, what'll happen is you might end up with this problem here. The two boxes are too close and then one bleeds over the other, especially if you're prompting with a color. So what SAM does is it changes this in to this. Now let me show you something cool. Suppose I have a plain image and that image is, let's say, purple. As you already know, I can use Preview Bridge to apply a mask and then convert that mask into segs and preview it, right? Now, because this mask forms a contour, I can enable contour fill, and then this becomes a full mask. This is a very useful feature when your mask has holes in it. All I need to do is turn on contour fill. Now, when I run the workflow, those gaps will be filled. I will provide the solution to the assignment in case you wish to replicate my exact results, and we can end it there. And before you leave, please like and subscribe. If you can afford to chip in towards free curriculum, please consider supporting me on either of these platforms. Anonymous Dudu bought me my second ever coffee. Thank you so much. And huge thanks to Thessaly, my one and only Patreon, supporting me for nearly 5 months. I really do need to start putting together some diplomas or certificates to issue. Anyway, that's it for me, folks. Thanks for watching and class dismissed.